You have talked about how you have stabilized and how you have literally changed the face of the Chamber of Commerce in Kenya here, and how you have reached out to try and create relationships with many other developing, industrialized, third world countries, all of them, because I see that in all the pictures you have in here. Are you aware that we are actually increasingly getting isolated right now because the so-called East African community is not going anywhere? Tanzania is coming up with every reason not to be part of the East African community, particularly in terms of that free access. The non-tariff and tariff barriers to trade was supposed to have been removed. Tanzania is not doing that. Uganda is increasingly focusing on using Tanzanian ports. Burundi is using almost 100% Tanzanian ports. The only country that's using us right now is Rwanda. So we have a problem in the East African community. In the north, there's a new movement that is picking storm, and that is the so-called Afro-Asiatic countries, that is Ethiopia, Eritrea, Djibouti, and Somalia, trying to create their own bloc.
Mr. Speaker, I think we've got to
put. Let me just finish what I was saying.
Yes.
And in the north, that storm is building up. They're coming together into a powerful economic bloc with a lot of natural resources. The longest coastline you've ever seen in any part of the world, except maybe America, which of course is surrounded by sea all over, except the Canadian and the Mexican border. So are we not getting isolated? Tell me.
I think it's a very good question that you've asked me, but let's put some context to the conversation.
Yes.
First of all, remember, Africa contributes only 3% of global trade
Yes.
and less than 4% of global investment. So from a global perspective, we are a very small player. Having said that, you see the fact that there's many things that are working for our continent today. Now, one, we have a youthful population. We are the biggest workforce of the future of this world. Now, if you look at it, by the year 2050, the population of Africa will be larger than that of China and India combined. There's infrastructure being deployed. You know, for the longest while, there's been no infrastructure. Congo, which is possibly the richest country on earth, doesn't have a single road connecting two cities. You cannot go from Goma to Kinshasa by road because there are no roads. If you look at, the intervention of modern medicine, people are living longer. Resources are being discovered, oil is being discovered, minerals, etc. So if you look at the dynamic of Africa today, and the argument for intra-African trade is what an American would call a no-brainer. Why? Because we just simply have to trade with each other. How do we explain that 50 years after independence, we don't have a single vessel plying Lagos to Mombasa? It is still easier today to import a container from Dubai or from Southampton in England to Mombasa than it is to import one from
Lagos.
Lagos to Mombasa. So for me, I think, oh, you see, regional trading blocs like East African Community, like ECOWAS, like what we are seeing forming today around Somalia and Djibouti, the Maghreb states of Morocco, Tunisia, those regional economic blocs are good because they then create their own competitive and comparative advantages and their own economic value proposition. Now, you talk about East African Community. What we are seeing are teething problems around the fact that the political goodwill is not matched by bureaucratic implementation. Good case in point is Kenya and Tanzania. We still see, we've talked, the summit of the heads of state will go, and they'll have a two-day conversation around non-tariff barriers.
And have a communique.
And the day after, the moment the motorcades cross back into their jurisdictions, the NTBs are back, and the Kenyan trucks going into Tanzania are delayed and slowed down. For me, those teething problems are a consequence. They are a part of the problem that we have. The moment we backtrack on regional and intra-African integration, that is the moment we start to lose the plot. Because the case, you see, right now, intra-African trade is about 12%. If you compare this with intra-EU trade, which is at 73%, intra-ASEAN trade, which is at 40%, intra-American trade at over 50%, what good reason do we as Africans have to say we will not do business with each other? Now, regarding Kenya's isolation, there are political dynamics.
Undertones.
And undertones in the region that don't favor Kenya. But let's also remember that we need to be the ones with the bigger shoulder. We are looked at as the bigger economy. So everyone looks at us as the big brother. Let's look at this part with Somalia, for example. And my view very much is that whereas Kenya needs to maintain its diplomatic position with regard to those borders, and I think we need to resort to international maritime law, the law of the sea,
yes,
of which Kenya is a key stakeholder.
United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea,
yeah,
which you both me and you have done.
The Bible says, and I'm a Christian, it says, to him whom more is given, more is expected.
Yes.
So you see, for us, they expect more, other nations expect more of us. So if we start today to have an argument or a
picking up an argument
with
Somalia,
with Burundi, yes, I mean, surely, what are we talking
Somalia,
about?
Which has been a failed state, yeah, for all these years.
Exactly. Somalia, we are vested in a peaceful Somalia.
Yes, yes.
And it is an integral part of, yes, the way Kenya will move in the future.
Close to, while you're still on that point, there are close to 50,000 Kenyans working in Somalia.
Yeah.
And if the Somalia oil comes out, if Somalia builds its own ports out there and, yeah, begins competing with Dubai, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Then you can rest assured that 80%, 90% of all those imported workforce,
yeah,
the technical workforce, will be from Kenya.
We've recently, as a Chamber of Commerce, we've spearheaded a discussion with between ourselves and the Somali Chamber, mm-hmm, for a fishing protocol whereby Kenyan vessels and Somali vessels can cooperate in terms of harnessing the fish resources.
Which is massive in the other side.
The fish resources in Somalia are greater than Kenya's. But you see, if we allow their ships to bunker in Kenya, yes, and vice versa,
yes,
and there's good cooperation,
yes,
then it's a win-win for everybody.
And for them to bring their fish here.
We bunker, yes.
And we also and do the bunkering for them, yeah, right? Yes, yeah, yes.
So, you know, there's, to me, honestly speaking, I think it is, we'll be shooting ourselves in the foot if we start to go back on the conversation of intra-African,
yes,
economic cooperation.
Yes.
And on that note, I think it's one of the very unspoken about, but very powerful legacy of President Kenyatta. He's really gone out of his way to help on the intra-African trade agenda. I remember going to Abuja with him and really driving the agenda that we need to bring down the barriers.
That's the impression everybody has. Yeah. That's it.